You know, in science, few people really have original ideas. We all think that we do have original ideas, but few people really have. And it's such a pleasure to have two of the people that really have absolutely original ideas in science.
Now we're in trouble.
Science, here. And so I thought it would be an original idea to ask one of those to introduce the other. So I'm going to ask Brian Archer to introduce John Holland.
Oh, thank you. I'll put this over here. Well, I have a real sense of occasion here, and I'm absolutely honored and delighted to introduce John. I think Peter said in the first day that there is no single source for complexity science. It has a lot of roots. It came out of many, many strains of thought. There's no single person invented complexity science, but if there is anybody who has come close to that, it's John Holland. John is truly the father, maybe we could even say he's the grandfather, the great-grandfather, the father of complexity science. I was just thinking in my own mind, roughly, what John has contributed. I've been looking at lately some of my own papers. I'm throwing them together into a book, and I've been watching the debate at the Santa Fe Institute, and I've been listening to the lectures here, and I'm struck by how many of the ideas trace back to something that John has done. John wrote a book, an extremely influential book in 1975 on adaptive artificial systems. I may not have the title quite right. John invented the genetic algorithm, which not only is a good algorithm, but gives us a very different way of thinking. And that, incidentally, that's influenced biology, but via Axelrod and Hamilton, that went back in its turn to influence biology. John coined the idea of complex adaptive systems and complex adaptive networks. That was in his days at Los Alamos, or even before in Ann Arbor. As far as I know, John is the father of, or one of the fathers of, evolutionary programming, teaching computer programs to evolve and get smart as they go along. John, to my knowledge, is the initiator of classifier systems, which very much influenced me. And he is one of the very first people to do agent-based modeling. In fact, it was one of John's papers with John Miller where they talked about artificial adaptive agents. And this was in the 90s, very early 90s. And somehow that morphed into agent-based modeling. Now, in all of those fields, there may have been similar things done, say in computer science or in physics, but John has been central to all of those. I could add machine learning, parts of artificial intelligence, the good parts, John would say, induction and inductive reasoning. So John is one of the giants of complexity.
At 5 foot three.
At 5 foot three, yes. And he's also arguably the first PhD student in the world to get a doctorate in computer science. Technically, it was, what was it?
Communication
science. But all those degrees since have become computer science degrees. I went to a fest, or whatever you might call it, on John's, 110th birthday, probably is John's 70th birthday in Ann Arbor, and I was struck by, it seemed to be hundreds of ex-students who'd got PhDs. It's probably only three or four dozen, but it's a very large number. John is the recipient of a MacArthur Genius Fellowship or Award, and to cap everything, John has three daughters. For me, that's unbeatable. Having only two. But I think what I want to impress on you is that almost wherever you go in complexity science, major parts of computer science, parts of psychology, even parts of philosophy, John's ideas are there, and they're fundamental. And they have influenced us all, with John taking practically no credit, whatever, and sometimes not getting very much credit either. I want to tell you a story or two. I met John in 1987. The Santa Fe Institute was just beginning to open its doors. Nobody had ever heard of it. It was in a small town in the Rockies. It was pretty much a startup. There were maybe three people or four people and a dog. The dog might have been George Cowan. He was the president of the place, but it was not heavily populated. John and I were sharing a house. In my deep knowledge, I'd never heard of John, but I didn't know anything about computer science or adaptive algorithms or anything at the time. And so I thought I was sharing a house with a very affable man and very pleasant, told great stories. We would sit in the kitchen, drink beer, and John would talk about chess and artificial intelligence. I was learning an enormous amount. That time, there was a now famous conference in 1987, September 87, a famous conference where 10 so-called physicists and 10 theoretical economists were brought together. Ken Arrow brought the theoretical economists. Among those were Larry Summers, Tom Sargent, who's gone on to win an economics Nobel, Buzz Brock, many others, including myself. On the physics side, and this is what amused me, was John, Stuart Kaufman, David Ruel, who's a very good mathematician, Phil Anderson had organized that side. I remember I gave the first lecture. There was a lecture in the morning and one in the afternoon and a lot of discussion. And in the afternoon, we came back from lunch, and the next up was my housemate, John Holland. John started to talk about classifier systems and genetic algorithms. And I sort of was only mildly interested at first. And I thought, well, this is kind of different. I've never heard anything like it. There weren't any equations. There were the same pictures, by the way, John is still showing these days, almost 30 years later, of faces. How many faces can you make of 10 different sets of eyes, sets of eyebrows, and so on. And John was explaining all of this, and then he started to talk about classifier systems. And I noticed, I checked in on myself, and I noticed I was paying incredible attention. And I looked around the room, and there were a few people like Phil Anderson, who were paying great attention, and Arrow was very interested as well. And quite a few people were greatly interested. But there were two or three economists who were sound asleep. I won't say what the names were. And I have to say they've fallen into obscurity since, because they didn't listen to John. But I sat there, and the only way I can describe the feeling I had was listening to John talk about classifier systems. My feeling was, John Holland, if John Holland is the answer, what is the question? And I knew if I could find the right questions, John's ideas were the answer. It's the weirdest thing, you know, where you see the solution before you see the problem. Eventually that problem did become something. It became agent-based modeling in economics. That also has many ancestors. We weren't the only people doing that, but certainly the early ones came out of the Santa Fe Institute. In particular, an agent-based model of the stock market that John and I cooked up in 1988. I'll say one other word. So John has been extraordinarily influential in Santa Fe, in Ann Arbor for years and decades, in everywhere John goes and people he touches, I can see several of them in the room here, who might be in linguistics or subjects you would think are very far removed. So I began anyway in that afternoon, I suddenly realized my housemate was someone very different and very special. About a week later, John piled me into a car. We went up to Los Alamos, and there was a conference there. It was, I think, the first ALIFE, Artificial Life Conference, hosted by Chris Langton. And I said to John, well, you know, do you know anything about this? And John, as usual, said, what's all this about? John mumbled a few things and said he didn't know much about it, and et cetera, et cetera. John and I walked in the door, and the whole place came to a halt. And I suddenly realized I had arrived with God. And so, John, if I haven't sufficiently embarrassed you by now,
I'll
keep quiet. But suffice it to say, I think when the histories of complexity science are written, the threads, the major threads, will all lead back, not to so much to Santa Fe, but to Ann Arbor. And in Ann Arbor, they'll lead to John. And if you even go back further than John, some of them to Art Burfs, who had worked with and written papers, key papers, with John von Neumann. So this is an amazing lineage. And I think one of the great pleasures in my life is to have known John Holland. And I feel extraordinarily grateful that I have my name on at least one paper with John. my Holland number is 0 or 1 or whatever that is. At any rate, I'm thrilled that John is here, and I think we're all extremely privileged. So over to you, John.
Okay. Let's see if I can keep this all together. There we go. Okay. Is this coming through? All right. What I want to do today is spend about 25 minutes or so to touch on a series of ideas that I think are currently important and which I hope will cause you to argue with me or ask a lot of questions later. So what you're going to see is a kind of broad sampling of some things that I think are not being studied now and are really centrally important to these areas. So I will start, we hope, just so we all have some background in the terminology. Here's a sketch of a neuron, very standard. The one thing you want to look at is that a given neuron connects up to 10,000 other neurons. Now, we've never built machines like that where one element touches 10,000. If you look at a standard computer, that's usually called fan-out, it's 6 or 7. We have no idea what a machine like this would look like. So just as a starting point, keep that in mind. First thing I'm going to talk about is the way the central nervous system looks. And by that, I mean the frontal part, the part that's interior to the input and precedes the output. This is just a few facts about that. But if you look in this so-called neocortex, the front, it's organized into about 500,000 columns of neurons. There are multiple neurons in each column, but it has about 500,000 columns of neurons. And there are about 70,000 neurons in each column. Now recall again, each of those 70,000 neurons touches, each one touches 10,000 other neurons. So that means forcefully that there have to be lots of loops in there. The neocortex is just filled full of loops. And there's a recent article in Science, for instance, about a very small piece of mouse tissue with sort of the same facts that just pushes again on that same idea. And here's the thing that you find. The minute you start looking, that all possible loops, two at a time, three at a time, up to about 25 in length, are present. Now think of that. All possible loops are there. Not just this particular one or that particular one. And so if you use the binomial theorem to fuss around with this, you could calculate quickly that there are about 10 billion distinct loops in these very small regions. And just so you can see this, I've drawn all the possible loops I could get, three at a time, four at a time, five at a time. Gives nice diagrams. So when you have a loop, remember, neuron fires, and this is another thing people tend to overlook. In this system, even if you're sound asleep, every neuron in that system is firing at least five times a second. And that's very slow, typically faster than. So you've got all these loops filled full of spikes circulating around all the time. Now that's just a very different kind of organization than anything that anybody has studied, partly because it's very hard to study analytically. Okay. Now, if you think of this, let me go back before I talk about that. If you think about this, as the spike comes around the loop, it can help to restart the neuron that was at the start of the circle. So you take the spike, it goes neuron to neuron to neuron to neuron around the loop, and then that spike comes back to the start. You know, that's just a definite kind of positive feedback. Okay. Now, another thing that you don't see talked about very much, these are critical properties of neurons. First of all, real neurons do not have a fixed threshold. They start with a very high threshold, which is called the absolute refractory period, where you can't fire it at all. As time goes on, the threshold of that neuron begins to get lower and lower and lower, easier to fire. Okay. That's a critical property when you get these loop systems. If you didn't have that, you'd have lots of problems. Okay. The other thing that's usually not discussed is neurons, just like muscles, get tired. If they fire at a very high rate for a long time, then they build up fatigue, which in effect makes the threshold higher and higher. So they get harder to fire if they've been fired very rapidly for a long time. It's just like your muscle. If you're using it very rapidly, it gets harder to use. If, on the other hand, it is not firing very fast, rather slowly, because of a long loop, then that fatigue will actually go in the opposite direction. It'll begin to recover. And it can, in fact, as they say, get hyper-recovered. It could get so recovered that it gets easier to fire than normal. Okay. So if you look at, if you look at that point, this is a very typical kind of curve. Over the long-term average, and this I mean over hours or more, the thing has to always come back to that zero point. If it gets below, it'll get hyper-recovered. If it gets above, it'll get highly fatigued. So if you think about it, it'll always, in the long-term average, be there. And then the final thing I won't discuss this much, but there is a learning rule that was proposed way back in the 50s. In fact, earlier than that, I think it was 46 or something, by Donald Hebb. And his idea is if one neuron fires and then it's connected to a second neuron and that one fires just after the first one fires on the next time step, then you get a correlation. In other words, what we call the synapse, the connection, gets stronger. You can say this, if A fires B, but that's the wrong way to say it. If A fires and then B fires, the connection between A and B gets stronger. Okay. So those three properties will play a role when we look at loops. So we have one of these highly branched process, but we've got this long loop that comes back to the start. And the neurons in each of these subsets will fire simultaneously, so the spikes go around the loop that way. The important point is the longer loop, once started, remains firing for a longer time than a shorter loop. Now, if I was in front of my class, I'd say, why? Some of you believe what I said. A longer loop, once started, remains firing for a longer time than a shorter loop because the fatigue builds up less rapidly. And so it doesn't get hit by the fatigue as soon. A long loop, the neurons are firing more slowly, the fatigue builds up less rapidly, and so it can continue firing over a longer period of time. When you see that, and here's an example, I have two short loops that are firing away fairly rapidly. I have a long loop. I have a long loop that fires more slowly, so it will continue firing while those two shorter loops are firing. In effect, it becomes a representation for a sequence of two things that happened underneath. So this is one of the things you buy by loops. You, in fact, treat some things like building blocks to build up more complicated things. And again, you get this by the looping. Now, let's see if I can hit the right one. So loops with this property of treating other loops as building blocks are almost always there, because there are so many. And here's the slide that's been around forever. The business of building blocks is interesting. Notice, if you give a young child, and this is fun with me, it's granddaughters, of course. If you watch a young child playing with blocks, first of all, you can give them these very complicated block sets. And for a few days, they'll be interested, and then they just toss them aside. They go back to the ordinary building blocks that you've seen as kids. They just really, there are more possibilities. That's the reason. Look at what's happened here. You can form these four. Any child will do that very soon after they'll just make a regular array. Or they'll put two together and then put the two and two together. These things you can all form. You can form an arch out of these things, and about one out of every 4,000 tries will turn out to be an arch like that. Well, that's something a child will do. But now look at something like this. This is made up of this, 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 and this. The chances of reaching that at random are zero. But if the child treats these as building blocks for this, any child will build a castle like that pretty quickly. So this is a key point, that if you have these kinds of things, they can be used as substructures for something bigger. Now, I could put a structure up here that's not made of substructures, and the child would never get there. It's only because you can put these things together like this that you do. And notice now, we're talking about the same kind of thing I was talking about when I took those longer loops and shorter loops and put things together. The things you reach are the building blocks that are made of other building blocks. And it's, for instance, and Brian has talked about this very nicely, almost all innovations that we encounter, real innovations like the internal combustion engine, were made from building blocks that we'd known for a long time. Gears go back to Greek times, pumps, and so on. But the carburetor was Venturi's perfume sprayer. So that building block had already, we already knew how to do that kind of thing and so on. So what was new was putting those things together in a new way, not the building blocks themselves. So it's very important, in my opinion, when you look at systems, to be sure you try to pick out what the building blocks for the system are. Just as a point about research in this area, this new brain initiative that the United States is putting forward, you should read a little bit about that. You'll find that it's all what we call feed-forward nets, no loops at all. Not even an attempt to find interior loops. If you look at the same thing in Europe, that's what they're doing too. And if you hear this discussion of hidden layers, same thing. It's just feed forward. It's this old idea that you get a stimulus and then you get a response. And you know, no interior processing really, except just through the branches. IBM at Almaden is building a chip, which they call a neural chip. No loops. So my view of all this is that we're missing something very important for systems, and especially how the brain works, if we don't take these things into account. And here's something. That's funny. Okay, well, we'll do it that way. We'll come back to this in a little bit, but this notion of what constitutes a valid model, what's a good model. And I'll say this briefly now, and then we'll come back to it. We have out there a world that we're trying to observe, and any attempt at a scientific investigation is going to use a bunch of instruments. Okay, here they're called D1 through DK. So I've got a set of instruments that I'm using to observe the world. I also have to set a time interval at which I'm going to do successive observations. You know, if I'm a pilot and all my instrumentation, what's on the control panel, then that may be every tenth of a second. If I'm an astronomer, it may be months. Okay, so the two things you'll have to specify: what are the instruments you're using, and what time interval between observations. And what I would like, if my model is valid, is that when the world moves from here to here, and then I take an observation, my model should produce the same thing. Now, for the mathematicians, that's a homomorphism. And the general discussion, this is usually called commutativity of the diagram, that if I go this way and down, I should get to the same place as if I go down and across. Now, in what we're talking about with building blocks, and this is something that Gell-Mann points out, if I go three orders of magnitude, I've got a new set of laws every time. So if I go from individual water molecules three orders of magnitude up, then I got the laws of fluid flow. Now, there's often a big mistake when people talk about reductionism. If I look at fluid flow, I can have a set of laws that are not determined by any of the laws below, but they can't violate the laws that are below. The laws, I can't violate the laws of molecules, or I won't, that fluid flow equation won't be accepted. So the key point is that new laws are constrained by laws at lower levels, but they are not determined by the laws at lower levels. And that's really important. A lot of the arguments about reductionism do not really take this into account. Now, one of our tests on this kind of thing, because it is complicated, is to try to do an agent-based model of language acquisition. It turns out also that when you look at language, a lot of what you find is also relevant to language evolution. Unlike the same statement in biology, which rarely is true, but in language there are some real relations. Okay. One thing that, oops, here we go again. One thing that we wanted is that there's no explicit a priori value assigned to language. We want language to emerge not as something where somehow it's hardwired to begin with. This is interesting. I have no idea what happened here, but I can tell from this, for instance, in the version that I had for today, this was highlighted in red. And so I know that somehow whatever's happened here is...
It has a mind of its own.
Yeah, yeah. Anyhow, these ideas were first presented to me by Helena Hongao. And I'll try to go through it just briefly. I hope it says the same thing. Yeah, well, that was... No explicit a priori. What's going on? All right. Okay. First, level zero, we're going to look at stuff that's pre-primate in humans and mammals. Pre-primate means that we can find these things in animals clear back, like, well, to just talk about animals, many animals imitate automatically. And the thing that we know about most typically is called imprinting, where, say, a young duck will take the first moving object and imitate everything that object does from that time on. And I've actually seen a case where the first moving object the duckling saw was a chicken. Now that's a bit of a handicap if you're going to learn to swim. So imprinting goes way back. You know, it's not at the level of humans. It's very early on. If I look at the ability to distinguish between objects and actions, you notice that almost everyone has a reflex that if there's something moving in the periphery of their vision, it's almost impossible not to look at it. It's a survival characteristic in traffic, but it's also a survival characteristic at a very early stage. Okay. Another thing that you see, for instance, in pack hunting animals like wolves, they are aware when two of them are looking at the same object. And that's how, in fact, they manage to cooperate in order to single out a particular animal that's going to be the prey. So that's also, you find this knowing that you're both looking at the same object. So these are all pre-primate, and then we need some learning procedure like Hebb's rule for the learning procedure. So we find, we call this level zero because it's wired in. Has nothing directly to do with language. It's just there to begin with. Okay. Then we could go on. One of the first things that you see in a child, you know, anybody who's watched a young child, their hands wave all over the place, and they're making random sounds and so forth and so on. But there comes the day when the child, for the first time, moves its hand more than once in the same direction across the vision. It's the first time that the child exerts any control on its universe. And if you've ever seen a child do that, the smile is just unmistakable. They really, really know that something good has happened. Okay. And if we were to do the kind of thing that Brian was talking about, if we try to do this in a rule-based form, then this signal processing would be of the form, if there's a hand in the vision code, then move the hand right. In other words, the child has learned that rule. or I shouldn't say it exactly that way, we can describe what the child has learned by that rule. I won't spend a lot of time on these, but we go up step by step to these levels. Here's something that's important, social interaction. And at that level, which we call level two, if the child sees a milk bottle, then it makes the utterance, the sound, milk. And again, you'll see a strong interaction between the child, usually the mother in this case. And so that's moving up the level of language to a more sophisticated kind of response, not language in the usual sense yet. And you can go on. I'm not going to spend time on this now, but we went through these levels of consciousness, as they're called, and finally you get to the point where you put something like, if the child is hungry and there's no food visible, then utter milk. And the teacher acts to bring the milk bottle into view. Now this is much more sophisticated, where somehow the child can't even see the milk, perhaps, and knows enough to make this sound, and the mother then brings the milk bottle. And you can go on from there. Our idea here, and I think this is really possible, and in fact, I'll be working with Helena on the idea of actually building agent-based models that behave in this way so that we can actually test out some of these ideas. Now, important here, that means that we can see if these agent-based models are adequate to produce the behavior. That doesn't prove that the behavior is produced that way. It just says we can describe it that way. That's an important distinction. Now, again, this notion of building blocks, that a grammar gives us a way of combining things. And in this case, we have, this is amazing. There actually are two lists underneath adjective and noun. So somehow this has gone back to a very different version of what this is. Okay. Anyhow, if those were in there, there and there, there would be 12 utterances, and you could make something like 60 meaningful triples from 12 utterances. And then, as we all know, as the number of utterances goes up, the number of meaningful triples goes up very steeply, to the point that if you have a vocabulary of maybe 1,000 words, you may never utter the same sentence twice, unless you're a lecturer. This is wonderful. There wasn't any blue in it. Okay, so if we're learning one of these proto-grammars, a possible grammar, we wind up with babbling, which is just random actions, until we get that guided hand movement. We get meaning, which emerges from generalization, that you put the words together in a new combination and something else, something new shows up out there. And finally, generalization of sequences to grammatical rules. When we get done here, I want to look and see what the label is for that. Because I think what we got was something called consequences instead of consequences revised.
I don't actually speak IBM, but if somebody does, maybe we could try to reload the different...
Yeah, well, this will do for now. This is enough to start arguments. Okay. So, the language model is a signal processing, agent-based model situated in an environment. The survival of the agents... I'm sorry, the survival of the agents is the sine qua non for the survival of the language. If the agents, if it doesn't help them survive, this agent, if the language doesn't help them survive, then it's not going to survive. I won't talk about this. This is definitely not that slide. We need some of this.
Well, we can have a look.
Yeah.
No guarantees, John.
Because I can talk verbally about some of these things, but the diagrams are very helpful. One thing I'll talk about while they look. There should be something on there. It's on the desktop. It's not in a folder, and it should say.
Maybe she chose the wrong version of the.
Yeah, that's what I'm beginning to think.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, while they're looking, let me talk about the following thing that is important. There are three distinct kinds of models that have very different purposes and are often confused in the literature. The first kind of model I will call data-driven. And a data-driven model is one such as when we're trying to predict weather. We've got lots of data. We're trying to organize the data so that we can make predictions. So when we talk about a data-driven model, we're talking about the kind of model where I get this commutativity of the diagram. And that tells us, in effect, whether that data-driven model at least is a possibility. Okay. So keep that in mind. Data-driven are the models that we almost always see in everything from weather prediction to economic predictions and so on. And there's, of course, a lot of discussion about big data, but data-driven means if you're going to do modeling in the data-driven sense, you've got to specify what are the instruments you're using for the observation and what's the time interval between observations. If you don't do that, you can't really talk about a valid model in that area. Now, a very different kind of model is an existence-proof model. And once again, the name von Neumann comes up. Before von Neumann did his work, it was thought to be a distinctive characteristic property of life not possessed by any machine that it could reproduce itself. Self-reproduction was considered to be, if you read any of the textbooks at that time, that was a property only of living organisms. Von Neumann comes along and shows how to build a machine that can reproduce itself. Immediately, that whole idea of saying that living organisms are the only thing that can reproduce themselves gets shoved aside. He's shown an existence proof that there is a machine. Okay. Now, the third kind of model is an exploratory model. That's where you have some mechanisms, think of them as building blocks, that you want to see, if I put them together in various ways, what will they do? I'm just trying to explore what these mechanisms can do. Now, that's still different from either the existence-proof model or the data-driven model. So we have three kinds of models, and if you read the literature, you'll be surprised at how often these three different kinds of models are confused. Okay. I'll just repeat a couple of points that I think are very important. One is this business that if we're looking at a data-driven model and we want to build a valid data-driven model, you have to say what the instruments are you're using to make the observation, what's your control panel or whatever it is for the airplane, what the interval is between successive observations. Those two things you have to specify in order to get what we would call a valid model, which means this connectivity, commutativity of the diagram. So, claim no model is valid in the technical sense, no data-driven model is valid in the technical sense unless you specify the instruments you're going to use to make the observation and the interval between observations. And then, if you do that and you get this commutativity of the diagram, you have what's called a homomorphism, or what I'll just call a valid model. So point one, for data-driven models, that's the critical issue. Point two, for existence-proof models, you have something very different. You're just trying to show something is possible. And that's the von Neumann thing. Point three, the exploratory model is one where you have a set of mechanisms and you'd like to know what some of the possibilities are. And I'll say again, if you read the literature in this area, those objectives are often very confused and people don't distinguish them. So that's one key point. The other key point that I want to make is, and at least most of that point was made, that if I'm talking about your frontal cortex, there are loops upon loops upon loops in that area. And so the behavior depends, as we were showing, on the interaction of the loops. Longer loops, shorter loops, that's what makes possible the ability in your frontal cortex to do things like planning or to build up sequences that you try out, like playing chess. That's critical. And just as an aside, people have been working for a very long time to build what the Japanese call a go player, or wei ji in Chinese, and we still don't have any program that will play at the level that's other than somebody who's played the game two or three or four times. Now, you have to ask why that's so. What's the difference? And in part, the difference is that when I look at things like the IBM chess playing machine, that machine could explore all the alternatives down to a given depth. And that's essentially what it did. It did only a minor bit of learning. On the other hand, Go has so much branching because you have first 19 squared first moves and then on down that you can't approach it that way. You have to do something much more clever. You have to find the building blocks for the game. And of course, anybody that's looked at that can see all the manuals out there. What are the opening moves and so forth and so on. So you need the right building blocks and then planning based on building blocks. So again, this is a critical difference between the kind of thing where I can do exhaustive search and the kind of thing where I have to somehow do something more clever. So these things are just things that we should look at. And now I'm trying to recall, at the very end of the other slide, I had three very, what I considered, big open problems that are accessible if you begin to think about them in a different way. And one of these is something that Brian and I have both been interested in for a long time, called hierarchies. How do hierarchies form? What are the mechanisms that cause hierarchies to change? Every complex adaptive system we know is just full of hierarchies. Biological cells, international trade, all these things. What is it that allows hierarchies to form? And a suggestion there is what I'll call gated urns. This is where you have an urn and you pull a ball out, and then it can only leave the urn if it has the right tags, the right color, to go through the gates, the exit gate of the urn. And then you pick an urn nearby, and it can only go into that urn if the right entry gate is there. So you put the urns up, and then what you want to do is have the gates control the ball's movement. Well, if the gates are specified by these kinds of rules we were talking about, then I can do genetic algorithms on the gates to get new gates to see if I get new hierarchies. So claim is that that's a useful area, and I will do what I usually don't do. I will advertise my most recent book called Signals and Boundaries, which is built around gated urns. How should I say this? Well, quite simply, there's a brag that goes on with that. That's published by MIT Press, and in the year since it was released, it went from a first edition to a second edition to now a paperback edition. So I feel that at least it was partially successful. Okay. Let's see. I'm trying to just recall what some of those problems that I had listed at the end. Origins of hierarchy. Oh, yeah. Another thing along those lines is, how many of you, I'll ask this in the positive way. How many of you know how human vision, or in fact mammalian vision, works? Almost all models of vision do the raster scan kind of thing. That is far from the way your vision really works. And I could do an experiment up here. If I took a tablet that big and tell you to look at the center of the room. Oh, thank you, Brian. And I take the tablet and I put the letter F on it. And then I ask you, keeping your vision to the center of the room, how soon would you be able to tell whether it was, notice it's going to be this big, how soon would you be able to tell whether it was an F or an E? Any guesses? If I start over here, it would have to be just about here before you could tell. In other words, your vision doesn't work by a raster scan. It works by what are called saccades, jumps. And you look and take a very sharp snapshot of a very local thing. Now, the amazing thing, and that's part of what these loops in your central nervous system do, the amazing thing is you have the feeling you see the whole room, or at least everything in front of you. And it's also interesting that if I ask you a question about, say, a painting that's in the center of the room, your jumps will immediately go to the relevant part of the painting. So they're controlled. They're not random. Okay? And this, again, I claim is due to all these loops, the ability to put this stuff together. So real vision depends on saccades that are then integrated to form what you consciously think of as a picture of the room. Now, there is not, we have an expert at the University of Michigan in the physiology of saccades. She's done a lot of measurement. There is not, to my knowledge, a single model that's been built that uses saccades to do pattern recognition. And to give you an example why saccades might make things easy, the way these things work, you have the central sharp snapshot, and then you have a kind of very blurry periphery around it. And the way saccades work, for instance, I say, is that a smiley face? It looks and it sees a round blob. I mean, you know, I shouldn't call it a blob, a round sharp image of a circle, say. Also, at the same time, off to the right is a blurry area. And so, in effect, what the system does is say, well, if I move over there and it really is a smiley face, I'm going to see another round circle. If I do, then I'm partially confirmed and I continue the search. If I don't, it's not a smiley face. So this is very effective. And my claim is that any student that wanted to take this seriously, this would be a very reasonable doctoral dissertation that could be done in a fairly short time, you know, on something like a smiley face, just to prove the point. Okay? So if you look at the way this thing would work, it would see a sharp round circle and a blob off to the right. It goes off to the right, sees another sharp round circle, sees a blob diagonally down, It goes down, and that's a vertical, and then it sees a blob straight below, and that's a horizontal, lo and behold, smiley face. That's very different from a raster scan. And that's part of the reason that raster scans are so inefficient. They really don't do the kind of stuff that we expect of human vision. So that's another one of these areas that I think is well worth looking at. Now let's see if my memory will work to pull up the other one. Hierarchy, saccades as a kind of control mechanism, and No, for the moment I don't pull up the third of these three what I consider very open problems, which are not impossible to solve. What it takes is looking at them in a different way. Brian said, and my mentor was Arthur Burks, and he's not widely known, but he wrote a paper with von Neumann, the first paper, and he was first author, Burks, von Neumann, and Goldstein, on how you program a stored program computer. This is a famous paper. And he also edited Charles Peirce's papers for Harvard. Peirce was the, many people think, the greatest philosopher that the US has ever produced. And he also finished von Neumann's work. He died while he was working on cellular automata and self-reproducing automata. So Art was well respected at the university. And I suggest to any of you that are working on a doctorate, which is something that's both fun and original, that you find somebody like that who's well respected, it's almost medieval, who will be your patron while you're doing your dissertation. Because Art would always just say to them when they would come at me, let him get on with it. and they paid enough attention to him that it was possible. And I'm sure without that, I would not have been able to do the kinds of things that I've been, you know, had the freedom to do. And of course, as you all know, in the end, if it's not fun, you shouldn't be doing it.
So are you making an offer, John?
Well, first you have to inquire what my fee is.
As John was saying.
Yeah. Okay, I'm just going to show this one slide. This was what I was talking about before, just so you could see. These are what I consider to be three important lines of research that have really not been touched upon in the literature. And so I just repeat them. One is this business of loops in the central nervous system, that a lot more could be done on that. And in fact, there are ways to do even some mathematics here. If you're careful and do it the right way, you could bring Markov processes into play. And just to give you an idea, if we look at these, I'll ask you a question first that will be good for you to think about. In one sense, it's elementary. In another sense, it's not. If I have a set of urns, let's say I have three urns, and I want to know how many ways can I arrange two balls in three urns? How many distinct ways are there to arrange two balls in three urns? And I'll let you think about that a bit. There is, it turns out, an easy solution to that problem. Okay, so that's one thing. Symmetry breaking was the one that I wasn't thinking about. There's a very famous paper, not well known now, by Alan Turing, of all people, who looked at morphogenesis. How do you start with a homogeneous system with no pattern and get a system with patterns? And his idea, for those of you with the background in science was reaction diffusion equations. And he showed very carefully how by having two catalysts, one of which diffuses rapidly and one of which doesn't, that you can get things like a spotted pelt or a tail with a dark tip and so forth and so on. So this is an area that almost nobody has followed up on since that time. And there's a lot you could do there. So I simply suggest this as another kind of thing. And then the mammalian vision was the other thing I talked about. All three of these, I think, I'm not saying you're going to get a general theory. I think all three of these are accessible in the sense that if you pick a proper part of it, you could do a doctoral dissertation in this area in a reasonable amount of time, less than 20 years. Okay.
Okay, thank you, John. So, did anybody figure out the question that you asked about the two bowls and the three urns? Okay, something for tonight then. So,
what's that?
Three.
Not quite.
The idea was to actually treat it as a Markov chain, I think.
Yeah, you could lay it out as, that's the starting point. Think of it this way. I have two balls, so think of them as zeros. Now, I have three urns, so how can I place the lines for the urns so that they separate the balls? Well, if I start with all the urns on the left end, I've got all the balls on the right. And if I do the calculation on that, it's in fact n plus 1 choose how many? 2. And that is the number of different arrangements that there are for two balls and three urns. N plus 1 because I can put all the urns empty at one end or something like that. So it's n plus 1 choose 2, and then you could see that that thing goes up hugely rapidly if you have many urns, or many balls for that matter. And then you could go on from there to calculate that, and then if we talk about the gated urns, we have to talk about the probabilities, and that turns it into a genuine line of a Markov matrix.
And we all thought that the answer would be 42. Okay, so I guess there are some questions, suggestions, remarks, starting off the discussion. John mentioned many, many things. I actually made a whole list of new thoughts that he brought to me that I would definitely want to discuss. But since it's your school, you can do the questioning. So whom can I give the first floor? Don't be shy.
Peter, just start with the first row and move around.
That would be nasty.
Yeah, especially since you force people to move to the front row.
Okay, while you guys are thinking, I have a question that I'd like to. And remember, we have also Brian, of course. Here. That's why, you know, normally Brian would do this moderation, but because I want to make sure that we also can pass some questions to Brian, I'm doing the moderation now. So one thing about these loops and about modularity, it seems to me that complex systems organize themselves such that they create thresholds, barriers that they need to cross. And so for me, it seems like that thresholds might be much more fundamental than modularity, which seems like a derivation, if you like, a second order process under the creation of thresholds. Is that something that you address in your book? Is that something that would be reflected by your signals and boundaries? Is there maybe something about the function, the role of thresholds, maybe related to how they emerge from evolutionary processes?
My treatment, Peter, and I, my notion of threshold got transmuted in the book to this notion of gates. And so a threshold is, in fact, whether or not the signal can pass through this gate sets a threshold on whether that ball could get in there. And then if you look at both entry and exit, so if I pick a ball out, first it has to get out of the urn, and then I pick another urn and it has to get into that one. That's my version of a threshold in that context. And then if I think of gates as looking for a particular, what I call tags, in other words, there's a bunch of don't care, and it says, I want this ball to be red or yellow or orange, but not purple or green. Then you notice that I'm going to build up the concentration of that ball inside that urn, much like the earlier description that we saw this morning. And you get those processes of that. And, you know, the other thing that I use in there is that I want to have these things interact, so I have to have, in effect, a billiard ball chemistry. And so whether or not two balls interact inside an urn depends on whether they collide. Well, if the concentration of red, orange, and yellow goes up, then there are going to be a lot more reactions between red, orange, and yellow than the other.
Looks a bit like a model of an immune system.
Yeah.
Like the Seiden model.
Yeah, we've actually looked at using this kind of thing as a kind of immune, because there's some people at Michigan that are very interested in that kind of stuff.
Right.
I have a question for John, and that is
is this water I'm allowed to drink?
Yeah, you can. These positive feedback loops, these neuron loops, they remind me a bit of mercury tube memories in early computers. And I'm wondering, do you think that these such loops are, maybe you said this and I missed the point, but I'm wondering if these positive feedback loops are acting as local memories, temporary ones, because once they start to fatigue, then they'll quit. But they're acting very much like in early machines made in England, early computers made in England by Turing and his friends in Manchester. They were using mercury delay tubes. What you would do is you'd send some signals down the mercury delay tube. They could be binary digits or pulses. And then they would reach the end. I think it was perfectly acoustic. And they would reach the end of the tube. And it would be sent back to the start. And you could keep some sort of binary number. It might be quite a complicated one, going indefinitely until you switched that off. And I'm wondering if there's something like that going on with your loop.
I think the analogy is a good one. Right, yeah, he's talking about before we didn't have any kind of memory that we know about now, not even the early cathode ray tube memories. This was the only way you could get memory into those early computers. That's a good, I think that would be very suggestive.
Yeah, in the 1940s, sir. Yeah. Even before your time, John, computers.
No.
But you were also talking about data-driven model, right? So I was wondering, you know, with these two big projects on the brain, like the human brain project that I know a bit of, that you said they don't address these loops.
Yeah, not at all.
But the question then comes, how would we be able to address that in terms of experiments? How do we get data, for instance, from the brain? So getting, measuring loops in the brain seems to be...
Oh, yeah.
They have these double pulse techniques now, in which they can just basically trace linear, but they cannot trace loops yet. So there's no way yet currently to do that.
As far as I know, in terms of gathering data, real data, I know of no way. But also, I sort of have this feeling that until I try to look at loops as loops, I may not know what data I want to gather.
Yeah.
Almost, because, you know, as you well know, almost all the current work now is based on the kind of stuff where you do have feed forward, those first few layers of the optic lobe and stuff like that. And then to the extent that they take data internally, it's, I think, Brian, you made the joke about the grandmother neuron. I mean, there's this tendency to want to say a given area only handles a given kind of data. And then, of course, what they find out is the minute that that area gets destroyed, something else takes over, some other area. The brain is extremely flexible at things like that.
Existential model that tries to prove that those loops actually have a role in memory.
That, I think.
So what you're saying, let's see if we get this right. So what you're saying, if we do have data on the linear structures
and we have models for that, data-driven models for that.
Right, and then we can do an extrapolation. Can we do an extrapolation?
Yeah, or modify the structure of the data-driven model.
Yeah.
To have loops in the model structure and then do a theoretical simulation
of
that sort.
Yeah, you could, often the movement is in that direction. You do an exploratory model where you've got the loops as the mechanisms, you want to see how you can put them together. And then you go from an exploratory model, sometimes it shows an existence proof, and then finally you go to data-driven. That sequence happens quite often. I mean, in research that we know about. By the way, I'll mention just as an aside, again, for the people that are in the sort of science physics area, the only person that I know of that ever wrote carefully about what kind of metaphors and exploration he did was James Clerk Maxwell. And he went from very simple metaphors like the, you know, he talked about a line of force. Well, that was a line pulling a canal boat. And he actually talks about these metaphors very carefully in his collected papers. And notice he goes from those simple ideas to these extremely sophisticated partial differential equations. And he's the only scientist that I know of that ever reported on his way of doing that. And yet, most of the scientists I know, and I would assume you too, use metaphor all the time to get started.
I don't think there's anything else in science. All science is metaphor.
In a way, yeah.
So how are you dealing with these things, Brian? You know, in physics, like in measuring things, signals in brains, people are able to actually measure things to some extent. But in economy, you know, it's unethical to do an experiment, right? So, of course, it's also unethical to open up someone's brain when it's still active. But so how did you come to actually, because it is like a thought experiment, basically, the kind of thing that you were doing. And how can you validate that?
I think that in economics, we are trained on a lot of metaphors. Graduate education in economics, I didn't do my PhD in economics, but I taught PhD students in economics. And graduate education in economics is, roughly speaking, the mastery of about 20 to 30 toy models. There's intergenerational transfer models. There's principal agent problems. There's prisoner's dilemma. Each of those is not just superficial. You really have to command all of those and use those as a grammar and vocabulary to express thoughts. And then if you're a working economist later, you can look at something happening, say, in Egypt or something happening in high tech in Silicon Valley and say, oh yes, I kind of get it. You know, we were talking this morning, Jason was talking about why Facebook acquired WhatsApp, yeah, for $19 billion. And I just came from Silicon Valley and the place was buzzing about that. But if you're an economist, you're trained, mostly in grad school or in research, to sort of say, yeah, what conceptual model can I wheel up to look at that? The one I would look at that with is installed base. It's not the value of the company. It's that WhatsApp has a huge installed base of users. So they're not buying a firm. They're not even buying what we'd call the IP, the intellectual property. They're essentially buying the user base. And so it's this sort of advantage that economics gives you. Most people, especially if they're physicists, sort of think, well, economics is for people who can't do physics. So I should put those words in your mouth, Paul.
No,
but I'm sure you subscribe to them. But anyway, economics, and I'm sure many other fields like this, neurology, medical science, is the command of probably one or two or three dozen metaphors, but to be able to use them quickly, easily, automatically, and unconsciously. And then you're asking how I came in some of the models I worked with, like the Polly-Earn scheme that was mentioned this morning. I thought it was incredibly cute. I think in cases like that, you get interested in a real world problem. And if you're honest, it doesn't fit any template metaphor that you have. And then if you're not very honest to yourself, you say, oh, I can shoehorn it into this metaphor and then publish a paper on looking at it that way. But if you take it and say, well, I'm not sure I understand that. And if you're willing to sit with that for 2 or 3 years or 20 years, you might say, I don't get how that works, but I can get a toy version of that to work and start to understand it. Much as John was talking about an infant learning the word milk, you learn little things. And I think this is particularly what complexity and the use of computers is all about. Say, given this or that assumption that doesn't fit the standard thing, we can try it out on the computer and see what happens. All my professors, I did take grad courses in economics in Berkeley. My professor said, well, by the way, a theorem I've just given is valid as long as there's diminishing returns on the margin.
Yeah.
Roughly means enough negative feedback so to get a single equilibrium. And I remember sticking my hands up and saying, what if you had increasing returns on the margin? I was just told to shut up. But the question stayed with me. And so anyway, I do think that it's not that we're always looking at reality. What complexity allows us to do is to bring a mindset that's much more experimental. That's why I've been learning NetLogo, I presume. That's why there's so many computer scientists in this area, and of which John's one. And these are people who think, like John did, what would it mean, for example, to teach a computer to play draughts or checkers or to play chess? That was a question John and Art Samuels were wondering about in the early 1950s and trying to do. So I think what a lot of modeling is allowing us to do is to ask questions. This would be at the exploratory end of what John's talking about.
By the way, and this is another one of those cases. Art Samuel was doing a learning checkers player in the early 50s, and that machine, and this is the kind of test that I find very significant, that machine learned to beat him. Now, that means that he didn't insert the knowledge that he had the way they tend to do now on chess playing or something like that. If it could beat him, then obviously it had to be doing something different from just what he put into it. And that machine actually went on to play checkers at tournament level. So it not only learned to beat him, it learned a heck of a lot more. That paper, even after all, and why nobody in artificial intelligence followed up on that is a story in itself. I mean, that was a real breakthrough, and here we are. Half a century and more later, and still nobody has followed up really on that paper.
I have another question for John, if the audience is being a bit quiet here. I would like to know, John, your version of where complexity came from. You know, especially some of your own experiences in Los Alamos, in Ann Arbor, and with the Bach group. But something came that in the 80s came to be called complexity. But before that, it didn't really have a name.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering what your recollections are.
Well, my recollection at this late age when memory is fading and all those things is that my early interest was in interdisciplinary stuff. I like cross-disciplinary things, and that was really what started me. I, at MIT, and I won't follow up with any more stories, but this is at MIT in those days when you had to do a dissertation in physics to get your bachelor's degree. And the person that I went around knocking on doors because I had had a course from a guy who was an astronomer who taught what we would now call algorithm theory, was working in the electrical engineering department, and had access to what was the first real-time computer called Whirlwind at MIT. And he later became chair of astronomy at Manchester, and he got me the necessary clearance, because this was considered confidential, so that I could write a program for that Whirlwind computer. And so, you know, already I got the advantage of a lot of cross-disciplinary stuff at that early point.
How did that lead to complexity? How did that lead you into?
Well, the more you do cross-disciplinary stuff, the more you bump into complexity, is the way I'd say it.
This question here.
I think it's more of I'm kind of curious how the idea developed. So when we're talking about genetic algorithm or classifier, you are coming from a very different background to what we used to do, whether economics or mathematics. Now it's accepted. How did it come to you, this idea?
About genetic algorithms?
Like,
yeah. Well, mostly it was because I was being exposed to these different things, and I'd always liked biology and Darwin, just because I liked it, so it was partially. But I always thought that you couldn't do much mathematics in biology, and what happened was when I came to the University of Michigan, I was working on. I had actually started a dissertation in mathematics. And there they had OpenStack library, and I'd go wandering down the library just looking at titles that I thought was interesting. And I saw Fisher, the famous statistician, Genetical Theory of Natural Selection. And I thought, my God, here's a book on mathematics handling a real problem that Darwin was interested in. And that just got me. And I thought, well. And really, my major theorem for genetic algorithms was just taking Fisher's theorem, which dealt with individual positions on the chromosome, and said, well, this gene will grow faster or slower than this one. And I thought, well, you should be able to work with groups of genes. And that was simply what drove me on. I thought, well, this is possible. You could generalize this theorem to groups of genes. So that's how I got into that.
Keep asking all the these are great.
Just walking to a library, that's the idea.
Yeah. Oh, it's so much fun. It's yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure that you go to a place that you've never been before. There was another question.
I have a question. Because since the complexity size is Mr. Hawking, say 21st century would be the century of complexity. But until now, for example, like as a computer science, I also study computer science, but still, so in the computer science, they're also doing some like data mining, pattern recognition, such kind of stuff. But in the meantime, the complex system world is also doing the similar stuff. But how what's your opinion about this like parallel
event. Yeah, yeah. Well, a couple of things. Complexity is another one of these things like life and consciousness where you don't have a sharp definition. I can put it this way. Take a pile of sand and now take one grain away at a time. At some point, every person will agree, well, there are just a few grains on the table. It's not a pile of sand. But going from one to the other, where are you going to draw the line and say, well, now it's no longer a pile of sand, it's arbitrary. There's no sharp definition. So we have these topics without sharp definition that are very important to us. So we have a perfectly good science of biology, even though we can't give a sharp definition about where something is living or not. And that you have to deal with, and that's part of, I think, what's happening, you know, following Hawking's point, that we don't have a full theory, we don't have a sharp definition, so we have to push ahead in ways that, you know, are a little bit uncomfortable. But I still very much believe that a lot of the progress, well, I'll give you one example, which is a nice one that has just been revealed in the last 4 or 5 years. We have these, you know, in computer science, we have these problems that are called, you know, hard problems, NP hard, or, you know, various terms, NP complete. Recently, somebody started studying those problems. Now, an example of such a problem that the lady next to you has worked on is graph coloring, where you want to, Now, it turns out that the vast majority of problems of graph coloring are either obviously solvable or obviously unsolvable. And there's only a very sharp transition in the middle where you get into the area where it truly begins to approach NP hard. That, and so far that hasn't been exploited very much, but it's a very interesting fact. And what's even more interesting is if you count the size of the problem as the number of nodes, then as the number of nodes increases, this area where you genuinely get into hard problems gets narrower and narrower, a smaller percentage of the whole. That's an area which suggests new ways to approach the solution of those problems by pushing in from the outside. So that's again, one of these cases where we don't have sharp definitions, but we can make progress.
There was another question here somewhere. You have one? You have one.
Yeah, actually, it's following with the previous one. You said that you found this book on biology in the library. Did you find some time a book about earth science and seismology and earthquake prediction?
When do earthquakes occur? I did bump into that, and because I'd had all, for some reason, from when I was very young, I was always interested in biology. I thought it was really interesting stuff. And it was that collision of interest in biology and suddenly discovering that you could do mathematics in biology that sort of took me in. From there on, I was, you know, trying to see what I could do in that area. So the answer is only later to these other parallels like forest fires and epidemiology and something come along. And Brian mentioned this odd group that we had at the University of Michigan with no support called the Bach Group, because the four major people involved were Burks, that I mentioned early, Axelrod, who's done The Prisoner's Dilemma, Cohen, and me. And that group met for over 30 years, about twice a month, without any support, just because we were interested in things about complexity.
Yeah.
And I, you know, when those things happen, it feels very good. I mean, that's, you know, where people, and out of that group came the, a topic, for instance, that now is being raised as if it were totally new. Hamilton, who some people think was the best biologist of the 20th century, and Axelrod worked on this business that recombination, crossover, is what allows animals that do that to stay ahead of their predators, which are usually diseases or something like that. And so you've got this kind of Red Queen's race, but they're always staying ahead. Recently, in the last couple of years, there have been a whole series of papers about how parasites determine the direction of ecosystems as if this was entirely new.
Oh. As a separate field, or how do you see it coming?
Well, I'm extremely biased. I mean, this signals and bias and signals and boundaries approach is a path that I think lets us see. Another way to say this is we've had a lot of talk about networks, but little talk about the evolution of networks. And I think that's a critical issue. I think there's a great deal to be gained there. And that could start by looking for mechanisms that cause the evolution of a network. And we have, you know, we have this idea about attaching a node to the most active nodes or something like that. But that's not truly evolution. That's because there's no environment that's pressing one way or the other. So you just get my bias. In the sense that I think there's a lot of ground to be made about how these boundaries evolve.
But do you see it as developing as a theory like mathematics or statistics that will be used everywhere, or do you see different paths?
I'll just give another bias. I think most of the really hard problems in this world are about complex adaptive systems, whether it's trade or whether it's ecosystems or whatever it is. And so my feeling is that we will develop techniques for handling complex adaptive systems. They won't be broadly applicable, or I think they're unlikely to be, in the same sense that statistics applies seemingly everywhere. They will be tuned to complex adaptive systems. So I think we will get better ways to handle these what I consider the really hard problems in the world. But I don't anticipate that the techniques will spread over to other kinds of things, like back into physics, for instance. Might, but I don't think so.
I was wondering whether loops is actually an interesting thing, because it occurs to me that if there are that many neurons with that many connections, that almost certainly they're going to be subject to thousands and thousands of loops, unless the neuron can send a pulse with a path as opposed to no path. And surely then it's more interesting to determine some of the network theory of that rather than just whether they follow loops, because surely the whole thing forms a network that will, every pulse will be experienced by itself.
That's largely true, what you're saying, at least up to loops of a certain size. But think of this from the Darwinian point of view. I've got all these loops. Only some are relevant. And they're going to be selected under Hebb's rule because they grow stronger. So if I think of the loops as trying to give the system a way of processing information so that I can process it by doing things like looking ahead or alternate plans or something like that, that I see this vast number of loops as being grist for the Darwinian mill.
Do you see those loops at the level of the neuron, or do you see them at a larger level of sort of groups of neurons forming sort of super loops, as it were, of clusters of neurons looping together?
The individual neuron, to me, is not so interesting here. It's when that neuron belongs to a loop that comes back to it. That's, and again, you know, it's largely ignored that every neuron in your system is firing all the time. We've got a super parallel system where you've just got spikes everywhere. Again, we don't have any experience with machines like that.
Do you know if neurons can link to themselves without linking to another neuron?
No, because of this absolute refractory period. If they try to do that, all those connections die out very quickly under Hebb's rule. So that's, yeah, that's, again, one of these things. It's interesting. I mean, it does seem like this system has evolved into something useful.
Yes. Do you have a conception of how you proceed from the idea of loops of kind of arbitrary size? From that idea, working with simulations and analytically, to something like control of human vision by sight data. There's so many scales that you've got to bridge there. So how do you think we should proceed?
Well, and you mentioned a very nice thing. There's a person at Cornell. Her name is Jane Wong, who has done an initial thing that I found very interesting. She started, looked at the dragonfly, and it turns out that the dragonfly has a kind of saccadic control because it can make very sharp changes in directions, which it has to do because it has to live off of flying objects. And she starts clear down at the level of fluid flow, and it builds a model that goes up to the point that shows with this kind of saccadic control. It's interesting what it does. It's sort of like it winds up a torsion bar in the wing, and then when it has to make a sudden change of direction, it releases that torsion. And she's got a very a specific model of this with equations at various levels, winding up with fluid flow. And so, you know, it seems hopeful to me that there are things that can be done along that line. And we've talked a little bit back and forth about how to take control theory in general and give it this saccadic kind of flavor. So I'm hopeful there.
So can we control complex systems?
Yeah. Yeah, up to a degree. Again, the lady sitting over there has done it for.
Yeah.
We'll get her to talk about it.
Tomorrow
is her turn. Yeah, yeah. I think, you know, the question is not can we, but how much.
All right. Yeah.
And that's, again, where, well, as my mantra is, theory tells you where to look, and until you have a theory, you don't really know where to look. Yeah, that's all. Actually, that's a very nice thing, and it's part of the reason that I got so interested in language, because language is a good illustration. In Southeast China, they have about, they call them dialects, 200 dialects. If they were in Europe, they would each be called a language. There's just no question. Now, think about that. Why do people that are maybe 40 miles apart on a river maintain languages such that unless they go to Mandarin, they can't understand each other? Why do those persist? Why don't they just give up these dialects and speak Mandarin? And I claim that this is really a question about boundaries. This is an us and them question. If you speak my dialect, I trust you more than if you don't. And so there's a very definite boundary there that gets maintained because I know all these people around me in the village that speak my dialect. I trust them much more you know, in any village, you could have people that are angry at each other, but you still, this guy down the river, he's going to try to cheat me. And so I think languages and dialects, and the reason they persist, is this kind of social us and them phenomena. And then I would use my gated urns, where the balls are what trading I'm doing and that kind of thing, and how do I trade locally, how do I trade in this broader sense. I think that's an extremely interesting area, and that's part of the reason that when I could start working with Helena on language, I got so interested, because it's a good test case for this kind of stuff.
I think this is a beautiful moment to stop this wonderful discussion, because it's start already about thinking about tomorrow, and of course, I know from experience that we can go on forever. So thank you very much, John, and thank you very much, Brian, for being here.